We are in Amrutanubhava. And we are going to start the second chapter on Sri Guru Stavana, the glory to the Guru. And in the introduction, Swamiji says, in the first chapter, Sant Jnaneshwara presented the thesis that the Absolute has the potentiality plentily inherent. When this potentiality manifests, then a seeming duality appears. Here the important point is seeming. It is only as if. Actually nothing is happening, yet everything is happening. This duality has two components, one from the potentiality point of view and the other from the absolute point of view. Naturally, if there are two, so you have one view as a waker. And when I say that, are you aware of the three states coming and going every day, you have a different view, isn't it? Exactly like that. When the Absolute is referred to with reference to the potential, it is called Shiva. And with reference to the potentiality, it is called Shakti. Shiva Shakti are thus two aspects of the same truth. And what did we see? Consciousness and the mind, the pure consciousness and the mind, or rather Atman and the mind, are two components of the same. It alone is expressing as the consciousness and the mind, that one truth alone. Having given this main doctrine, the saint next said that the total world of names and forms is nothing other than Shiva and Shakti. Our total world of name and form is nothing other than Shiva Shakti. This is from the totality point of view. And he also said that it is an eternal phenomena. So, what is realization then? To be able to see that how this one consciousness is playing as the two and is pervading the whole world. Understand? There is no problem of trying to negate the concept of Maya or Avidya. Thus, Anvaya Drishti, that is all-inclusive vision, is obtained. This Anvaya Drishti having been established in the first chapter, Sant Jnaneshwara now takes up in the second chapter how to apply this vision in the Guru-Shishya relationship. So how do we apply the Shiva Shakti principle, the all-inclusivity principle because here again duality is there, Guru and Shishya. Guru is the all-knower, Shishya is the ignorant one. The Guru knows that Shishya is none other than the self. Shishya feels Guru is separate to him. See? So how? So here Nyaneshwar Maharaj is beckoning us to take that vision that was presented in the Shiva Shakti Samavesh and apply it here. Because if it is pervading the entire creation, the Shiva Shakti principle, it must, and you are a part of the creation, isn't it? Guru and Shishya. So it must be pervading you also, this relationship also. We have been in the last chapter, I have been always taking it from the consciousness and mind point of view. That was more subjective. But here, even in this dialogue that is going on, even in the dialogue that, imagine these are the words of Nyaneshwar Maharaj and we are the students, in that dialogue also, the Guru is like the Shiva Shakti and the Shishya is the manifestation of their Leela. That is, Guru alone manifests in the form of the Shishya. What does he say? The Guru is like the Shiva Shakti and the Shishya is manifestation of their Leela. That means the progeny of Shiva Shakti. The Guru alone manifests in the form of the Shiva. True. Apart from, if nothing is outside Shiva Shakti, they are all that there is, then all the variety that you see in this creation is born out of Shiva Shakti only. Everything. Nothing can be outside both of them, isn't it? So similarly, if Guru is the Shiva Shakti principle, then the student cannot be outside the Guru. Wave can never be outside the waters. Therefore, in the relationship of Guru Shishya, there is no duality. From whose point? From Guru's point of view. The consciousness alone manifests as the speaker at one point and as the listener at another. It's the same consciousness. Where is our attention? I have said it many times. Our attention is on the thoughts. We are missing the point. Your goal is not thoughts. Then what is your goal? What is your goal?
Consciousness.
Correct. Your conscious self is the goal. Or consciousness, the permanent principle is your goal, is your destination, isn't it? But then here we are sitting, where is our focus? On the thoughts, on the words, isn't it? And here what the teacher is saying, the consciousness alone manifests as the speaker and at one point and as listener at the other. So what is more important than the words is the consciousness on which the words are riding. If that is our goal, to come to any satsang or sit in meditation or listen to any teacher, is so that we migrate to our original nature. And that original nature is the pure consciousness. So pure consciousness is here and the consciousness is there. That's why we are interacting. You cannot gain knowledge from an inert thing. A transfer of knowledge cannot happen. You can still learn from inert word also, because this is all inert. You think it is conscious. Body is inert. Breath is inert. Thoughts are inert. Concepts are inert. This house in which the satsang is happening is inert. Space is inert, in which all the five elements are. So everything is inert, in inert only. But what is that because of which this inertness is even able to express, what is making it exist. That principle we have to put our attention on. For the dawn of knowledge and to dissolve the individuality in total surrender, the grace of the Guru is essential. Many difficulties come in the way of a spiritual seeker in the path that he has chosen. These difficulties can be conquered only by the element called grace. These types of grace play sport in the life of a seeker. So now the different types of graces will be enumerated. So to think that I can realize by my own efforts is going the wrong way in your life. Everything that is happening, even the thought that I want to realize, is because of grace. The efforts that are being put in order to move in that direction is due to grace. You are having a calm mind or having a focus and are able to understand what is being told is due to grace. And eventually abidance will also be as the prasad of the grace. So you don't come anywhere in between, because the whole journey is to dissolve the ego, individuality. And until unless this individual doesn't see the hand of grace in the most minuscule to the most ridiculous, in everything, so that he gets so obsessed with this grace that he starts seeing it everywhere, then dissolution is possible. Dissolution of the individuality is possible. The first is the grace of the scriptures, Shastra Krupa. It says, Shastra Krupa is represented by the scriptures which are available to us and reveal all aspects of spiritual unfoldment. So where do we come? Today's meditation, what we did, it is given in Bhagavad. And the Lord gives us assurance. The exercise that we did, if you do it for 1 month, your breath, you will be the master of your breath. It will be under your control. If it is under your control, mind is under. Yesterday also, same topic was there in Bhagavad. The mind is under our control. If mind is under our control, what is called mind under control? Mind under control is that mind which does not go after every stimuli that is available. That's all. It is happy where it is. And where is it? Within itself. So even then the senses are open, eyes are open, it doesn't want to go out of the eyes, ears are open, it doesn't want to go and listen, it is happy where it is. Now such an available content mind is applied to self-inquiry. But with an agitated mind, if you do self-inquiry, it is only temporary, it is a little bit of understanding but no abidance. The possibility of abidance is a far-fledged conclusion. So where did I give you that example, this exercise of meditation? From scriptures. What are the shastras? There are four categories. Remember, what is the first one? Tell. What are the four categories of shastras, scriptures? What do you term as scriptures?
Vedas.
Okay, first is the Agama Grantha, which is the Vedas. Upanishads are part of Vedas. What are Vedas? Vedas are revealed scriptures. There is no other to Vedas. Second category?
Nigamas.
Huh?
You said this, Nigamas. Agama, Nigama, both are Vedas.
Huh.
Vedas.
Second?
Prasthanatraya.
Prasthanatraya is studied for Vedanta. But what are scriptures? So first is Vedas, which is Shruti Grantha. Shruti Grantha means which were revealed to sages. Second is Smriti Grantha, that which is remembered. And under that come the 18 main 18 Puranas and the 18 Sub Puranas. They are the stories of different lords. Ganesh Puran, Skanda Puran, Linga Puran, Shiv Puran, Devi Puran, Bhagavat Puran, Vishnu Puran, so many of them are there. Brahma Puran. They are the remembered. How, what is given in that? How all the ideas that were presented in the Vedas, they have been given a form. They have been given a form. So here the idea is given, Shiva Shakti. But we have in Puranas that Shiva Shakti has been given a form. Shiva Shakti is nothing but potential and potentiality. Understand? So that which is formless in the Vedas has been given form in the Puranas. And the moment form comes, past and future, birth and death, appearance and disappearance, manifestation and manifestation. So how did this, the various aspects of the creation, the various potentialities, how that one potential through his potentiality is expressing as the various principles which are governing the whole universe, the creation. And this is a continuous cycle, unending. So in every cycle of creation, some master, in this case it was Vedvyasji this year, in this time, he remembered what happened in the past creation and he brought all the scriptures. So these Puranas, they were not available in Satyug, they were not available in Dwapar, Treta Yug, they were not available in Dwapar Yug. Towards the end of Dwapar Yug, it was required. Why? The intellect was becoming weak. So for the Kaliyug people, where the ability to discriminate is less, the ability, the staying power, the single-pointed focus is less, for such people, stories are given. So that this knowledge which is in the Vedas, same knowledge is presented in the Puranas also, but in a different manner, in a story manner, so that the knowledge continues. So this is the second type. First was Shruti, second was Smriti. Shruti was the Vedas and Upanishads, and Smriti was the Puranas, 36 Puranas all in total. Third is Itihas. Itihas is history. History is his story. His story comes under two categories again, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. These are the only two historical events that are worth contemplating upon. Why? Because your attention goes to that divine principle, Rama or Krishna. Our goal is not the collecting the data. Our goal is to get to the source. Ramayana is because of Ram, and Mahabharata is revolving around the birth of Krishna. So how to get back to that divine principle? Again, and what is his manifestation? In Ramayana, it is a perfect person, perfect son, the perfect husband, the perfect father, the perfect and different, perfect king, perfect brother, is it possible for one individual to be perfect in all various aspects of his life, always keeping in view what is the most important duty at a given moment? So you see there, he doesn't, first he's always the king of the people. So as a father, he's not first a father to his sons or a husband to his wife. He's first the father to the nation, to all the citizens. So then second is his wife and children. Today's politicians are totally the opposite way. They do all the hanky-panky and get all the votes, and then first go look at our present Prime Minister. 1,000 houses are burnt, people are burnt, and he is having holidays. This is not a sign of a matured leader. See, why? Family is more important than the nation. Where nation is, if you have got a position of a prime minister or a king, then the country, the people in the country are more important than your personal life. But in Kali Yuga it is like this, what to do? So, Shastra Krupa.
What are smritis like? Manusmriti, those ones?
That is, again, it comes, those are compositions of some people, person, no? So these are not composition. These are compositions from memory of the past. That in every cycle of creation, the Purana, the same gods are there. Because the same principles function. So the sun will be there, the moon will be there, the planets, maybe not these, maybe different planets, or the various galaxies, the gravity will be there, and all those things. So, because Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh are permanent, they only go become unmanifest at the end of the creation, and then again become manifest, just like you manifest every morning again. You think you are continuous one, no? So how do you continue? Based on where you left yesterday, you continue from there. That I have my wife, I have my brother, I have my sister, I have my children, I have my house. Same house you stay. You don't start looking for a new house. So exactly the same way. Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, this story became unmanifest with time. And when the appropriate time comes, again it has to be brought into manifestation. Who brings it into manifestation? Some equipment is chosen by the divine, and in this time it was Maharishi Vedvyas. So first was Shruti, second was Smriti, third was Itihas. Itihas is Ramayana and Mahabharata, and the fourth is the words of saints and sages, realized saints and sages. Their words are the final. If they say it has to rain now, it will rain. If they say if a person is incapable of conceiving, and the saint says no, you will get a child, come what may, nobody can stop her from becoming pregnant or conceiving a child. They outdo the rules of by which the nature is functioning, because they have recognized their essential. They are the supreme power. They have manifested that power within themselves, and they are able to break through the conditionings of time, space and objectivity. And when they say something or do something, here we are talking about the saying, whatever their words are, they are equal to scriptures. So four categories. And sometimes these words which they say can be reflecting what is given in the previous three categories, or it can be true. Sometimes it can be contrary also. But because scriptures also say we cannot say what saint must or must not do, They have got no jurisdiction over realized masters. So masters' words are equally powerful. They can, if the I'm not going to give any example here, but if scripture says something and he says no, it is not like that, then it is not like that because he's saying it out of his experience, because there are n number of angles of looking at this creation. You understand? So again, we'll repeat the four types of scriptures whose grace we need. First is the Shruti, the Veda. Second is the Smriti, the Puranas. Third is the history and or the that is the Itihas, which is Mahabharata and Ramayana. And fourth is the Santa Vachan, which is the words of the realized masters. So when we, what we are doing here is Santa Vachan. These are the words of a realized master. See, when we look at the various texts of Shankaracharya, that is Santa Vachan. When we look at Bhagavad Gita, that is Purana. When we look at Upanishads, that is Veda. Understand? So all the various compositions of Shankaracharya, which we have taken, Atma Bodh, Tattva Bodh, etc., etc., Vivek Chudamani, that is all Santa Vachan. That is not coming, we say Vedanta, yes, because the theme is that, but it is the composition of a great master. You understand? Yes, it is reflecting the thoughts of the Vedas. So first is Shastra Krupa, that whatever is being taught is being understood by us. We are not understanding contrary to what is being taught by the scriptures. See, this is also a great thing, that when we come, our ears, on our ears, the words of the scriptures fall, at that very moment, knowledge takes place. That requires a certain alignment within us. It requires a certain level of grace. What makes this one come every time a satsang is held here? She calls out to come in and sit in the satsang. For us, we feel animals don't have a mind. But something is attracting. Every satsang she is there. Grace. For sure, her next birth is guaranteed in a higher realm. Oh, but she ate so many rats and mice and birds. No sin, because no doership. That is her nature. See? Second, Ishwara Kripa. First was Shastra Kripa. Second is Ishwara Kripa. Ishwara is the infinite Lord. His grace is required. Ishwara Kripa is the grace of the Lord by which we come in contact with the scriptures and the teacher together. So, from the infinite, the creation did not come about. Isn't it? What are the first manifested? From the absolute creation, it came. But from absolute standpoint point of view, it alone is. It doesn't even accept the manifestation of Ishwara. Because it is complete. So for us, it is beneficial to say that yes, absolute is there, but Ishwara is also there, because we can communicate with him. We can talk. We can see he is the father of the whole creation. You know, Bhagwan Ram Surat Kumar, he was another great Mahatma from from Tiruvannamalai. His Samadhi is there. I met him in 1998. He used to say, oh, the father, the father is very gracious. The father is Allah, has made me who I am. Everything, father. Who is that father? that Ishvara. For some it is Shiva, so they call the Ishvara Shiva. For some people, that Ishvara is the Narayana. So it's okay. But we take it as one, the Ishvara, Ishvara Kripa. So if the interaction between Shiva Shakti or Shiva Ishvara and Prakriti has brought about this entire creation, then naturally I need the grace of Ishvara. So why did I come in contact with my teacher? Why did I come in contact with the scriptures? Why did I have from childhood an attraction towards the stories of the Lord? It's all His grace. Everyone is exposed with these type of things. They are plentifully available even today. In so many houses I go, some of them are showing them these unwanted shows on the TV to the kids. But my parents never bought me those type of things. They only bought me stories of the Lord. And never had attraction for anything else also. You know, Richie Rich. So we used to read. I'm not saying we didn't read that. But attraction was not there. See? So something we can only attribute it to the grace. Why? What is making you come here and listen to this satsang every Sunday? Is the similar thought we are representing in different flavors? It's not because you like it. No, don't never say that. It's not because of your destiny. No, it is not because of that. Then it is because of the grace. The grace is making you, which is expressing through you, is making you become available to a higher grace, the scriptures, so that it recognizes, so that the individuality can melt. So when you start, we have to develop a vision wherein every aspect of our life is pervaded by grace. Never it should come into our mind that it is due to my efforts. Never it should come into our mind that it is due to my prarabdha, it is due to my past life karma. No. Everything that is happening is due to grace. Whether it is positive or negative, because negative also, challenges, obstacles, difficulties, they all come only to make you grow further, not to trouble you. So Ishwar Kripa is the grace of the Lord by which we come in contact with the scriptures. So it is because of the grace that we come in contact with the scriptures. It is because of the grace we come in contact with the teacher who teaches us the scriptures or expounds the scriptures. And it is because of the grace that we are able to understand also correctly, as is the intention of the teacher. We are able to come into tune with the teacher and the scriptures so that we don't feel ourselves low. Individual feels he is low. What is that low? I am a part of this creation is too big, I was born in this creation, I'll die, then where will I go? This is feeling low. If you keep thinking like this, you'll get into depression. Then what is the scripture and the teacher through the scriptures expounding? That you are the infinite. Now you have to accept it. He said it so many times. The scriptures are saying it so many times. You have to start believing it. That you are never born and you are never died. That the entire world of this creation is a manifestation of your mind. It is not outside your mind. This will only happen by grace. This will not happen by your efforts. So as much as it is grace is required to recognize that the whole world is in your mind, and who is telling you? The scriptures. And when you come and read this script, if you, even if you take this book and try to read it, you will not understand it. But first you forget the book, you only look at the size and you go to sleep. Or the language is not understood. So then you need an interpreter who is able to put that in a manner in which you, your mind can understand and get inspired to see that they are not this minuscule teeny-meeny nobody in this creation, but instead they are one with the divine. Their focus was on the wrong side. So this will only happen when we are in tune with the grace. Grace of the Ishvara. Recognize there is some father up there. There is one, some God who is managing the whole show. And he is managing without managing. So if he made you, if Ishvara made you in his own image, absolute cannot make anything. It is complete. So Ishvara made you in his own image. Then why are you feeling so small? Why are you feeling like an individual then? If he is in, if he has made you in his image, then you should, the essence of yours is not other than the Ishvara. Then you must also have the same disposition as the Ishvara. And those people who have that disposition as Ishvara, they are called sentient sages. They were also born like us. So get there. Then third is Guru Kripa. Guru Kripa, Guru's grace. Guru's grace is the grace of the Guru, which is freely available to all those who approach him and want to know the truth. Because what is the disposition of the Guru? Everything is perfect, everything is one. He is established in that knowledge. So if everything is complete and everything is one, will he make an effort to go and change the world? Now observe what is going on in the world. A proactive approach in the world to make it better. But if you look at any true saint and sage, they never went and did anything. They allowed things to unfold. They only teach those people who come to them. They do not say, hey, come, I'll teach you. They may say it if they see the potential in that person and that person is not recognizing it. They'll not go to jails and try to reform the murderers if they are not interested. Some people are doing it. We want to go and reform the prisoners, and they themselves become reformed into a criminal. You see? No. So teacher is, guru is, whoever comes to the Guru Maharaj, he is ready to be molded. See, Guru is always available. So here it says, grace of the Guru, which is freely available to all those who approach him and want to know the truth. Like the sun is always available, but if you are not ready to come out of the house and bask in the vitamin D, it's not fault of the sun. We have to come out. We have to give attention to the sunlight. We have to open the curtains and windows and come out of the dark. At least seek it. Then it will become available. But if you are not interested, you are lying in the bed under the quilt and dark room, and the teacher comes and says, hey, come, it's time, 5:30, time for meditation. Five more minutes. For such a person, even if you give the highest knowledge, nothing is going to gel. The student has to be inspired. The student must make, do whatever it requires so that he is available to the Guru Maharaj. The way, freely available to all those who approach him and want to know the truth. The way it is, the truth as it is, the way it is, not with some interpretation. We are using all interpretation here, but our attention must be on, and all our language that we are using is self-cancelling. One chapter is one, the next chapter will be something else, third chapter will destroy all that you have studied before. Eventually, you are not allowed to hold on to any concept of the truth. And that is the job of a teacher. And that is the job of the scriptures. To mold your mind in such a way that you do not think of the truth as some idea or as a concept, but you come to realize it as your own self. The way it is and not the way we want it to be. So for many people we have experienced, and you must have also come across, oh, it was so divine. This is the way you want it to be. Truth is not emotional. Truth is not logical. Truth is not ecstatic. Truth is not anything that you can conceive through the mind. Understand what I'm saying? If there is, truth is not anything that we can conceive in the mind, then what it is? Get there and find out. But it is not the emotion, and yet it is supporting all. So this conundrum has to be solved, and that can be solved only with guidance. The Guru is indispensable to guide the seeker to be able to see the naked truth stripped of all preconceived notions and prejudices, and to adopt a lifestyle that will sharpen the inner sensibility to see the vision of this reality. Who is Guru? Who is established in the truth? Who is a student? Who is coming from the base of ignorance? He thinks he is ignorant. So, he who has clarity of vision, he who is able to see his student also as a perfect, the perfection within him, only he can guide you to chip away all those things that are impediments in his growth, in his purification, provided that seeker is available, the student is available. If that student is available, then the teacher will take the task of correcting. And he may correct by word, he may correct by action, he may correct by putting you in different situations, he may correct you by teaching. There are different ways. Teaching is a way where he teaches, but you understand, and while listening itself, the transformation takes place inside. That will happen only when you are available, without preconceived ideas, without judgment of the Guru. So, and what is that judgment of the Guru? That he is also a human being like me. If I don't know the truth, how can he know the truth? Is he realized or not realized? Should I study from him or should I not study? If I don't know if it is realized, then if I study, then I will, what will happen? I will also not be realized. See the doubts that come in the mind? So, what is the best way for the student to come out of this?
Not to have any preconceived ideas.
Mm. Remember Parshuram's story I told from Tripura Rahasya, it comes. When he went, he came across the Matanga Rishi. He said, "Who am I?" He said, "You are Brahman." He said, "Hey, Brahman, just like that you told me I am Brahman. I have killed 21 times all the warriors on this planet. I committed such a great sin and you are telling me I am Brahman. I don't need to purify. I don't need to do any sadhana, and you just said like that I am Brahman. No, no, it cannot be true. I don't think you know." He says, "Yes, yes, you are right. I don't know. I am not your teacher to explain. You go further on Mahendra mountain, there is another teacher there." He goes there. Dattatreya Bhagavan was sitting there. He says, "I come to ask, who am I? That previous person said that I am Brahman. How can I be Brahman without doing any sadhana, without doing any practices?" He says, "Yes, you are right." Now he knew what type of dose this fellow needs. So he sent him to the mountain. He says, "Dig the mud on the top of the mountain. Make a statue of the goddess. Give her a nice bed to sit. Give us a nice bed to sleep. From morning till evening, wake her up with nice bhajans. Make breakfast for her, but you eat. Don't eat breakfast. Then you give her lunch, but you eat fruits. Give her, make nice lunch for her, but you eat fruits. Then after lunch, she needs to sleep. Put her to bed, but you don't sleep. In the evening, prepare dinner for her. Give her food, but you eat only one meal a day, no dinner also." And this way he continued for 12 years. And then after 12 years of this disciplined living, because my guru said, "I have to do it, you know." So diligently he was doing it. After 12 years, one day a thought came to his mind. Who is more important? I dug the mud. I made the statue. I am going through all the difficulties and giving this inert piece of mud, which I am calling, I gave the name Tripura Devi, and I am making for this imaginary statue, I am giving all the respect and all the sacrifices and myself going through all the difficulties. Who is more important? Me who is living or that which is inert? With this doubt he went to Dattatreya Maharaj. And Dattatreya Maharaj says, "You are important. Then who am I? You are Brahman." He needed that type of treatment. This is where we judge. Point was judgment. I think he doesn't know. Then automatically you are guided to another one, where your journey is going to be longer or elongated. See? So choose how you want to interact with everything that is taking place in your life. The idea is, I don't want to run from pillar to post in order to search for a guru, because guru is a principle in the end. That is what a guru as a person will teach you. And he should teach you that, because scriptures are teaching you that. And what is that? That guru as a principle means the ability to come back to be the self with every stimuli that is coming, you are coming in contact with. Everything that you see, hear, touch, feel, taste, think, imagine, everything that is not in your control, that is in your prakriti, but everything is bringing you back to the self. When this is happening, guru principle is fully manifest within you. But this can happen only within you. This can happen only when you are in tune with the scriptures. You are surrendered to the scriptures. This can happen when you are surrendered to the teacher. That Eklavya was surrendered to a teacher called Guru Dronacharya in Mahabharata, but the teacher did not want to teach him because he had an ulterior motive. So he was not a true teacher. Yet, because the student was fully surrendered to the teacher, he goes and makes the statue of his teacher. Because in his heart he has accepted he is my teacher. And he became a better archer than Arjuna. He could defeat Arjuna. Just from the statue and his availability, he learnt the archery. He became a great warrior. See? So, it's not about the person who's teaching. It's about your availability. What is your judgment about a teacher? It does not matter to the teacher. But it will certainly corrupt your mind, the student's mind, because you are allowing options to appear in the mind. And therefore, surrender and becoming available to the guru is essential, or that grace has to be invoked. And the grace of the guru and the grace within your mind to be available is one and the same, because the self here and the self there is one and the same, appearing as two. The space outside and the space inside the room is one and the same, but it's appearing separate due to the walls. That's all. So the self in you and the self in the teacher is feeling seemingly separate because of the wall of the body. That's all. So go beyond the gross. Go beyond the gross. And all these things, which, what, for example, what I'm telling you right now, or what the scriptures are telling you, and I'm explaining the way it is being explained, this would not have been communicated or understood because you wouldn't have even opened the book looking at the size. Or the various other Panchadashi is there, Vivek Chudamani is there. So the words are made palatable, the words are made user friendly by the Guru Maharaj, so that we are able to gel with them and have a different vision towards life and towards ourselves than the norm. And this only happens due to communication. First was communication with the Ishvara. Actually, this Ishvara Kripa should come first. Because of Ishvara Kripa, Shastra Kripa comes in our life. And when we want to study scripture, this is what happened, I am seeing in my life. Because of Ishvara Kripa, sadhana began. Love for the Lord was there. Then because of His grace, Ishvara, scriptures came into my life. But I didn't understand the scriptures. Then by His grace again, He manifested as the teacher in my life. And that teacher taught me to see that there is teacher present everywhere. Have that type of vision. That is Vedanta. Because Guru and the Self are not separate. Now, who is this Guru? The Guru first comes in one's life in the form of a mother. So there is a famous saying, Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava. What is that other? Here it is, I am using the word Devo. Devo is the Guru, or the God. God is Guru. So who is the first Guru? The mother. Then comes the father. And then comes the empirical Guru. Laukika Guru. Laukika Guru means the teacher in the world. You went to school, the teachers were there. Well, or you have studied in an ashram, Acharya is there, isn't it? The one who taught you everything, the language, the science, etc. That is the teacher for this, for his worldly affairs. So we have physics teacher, we have chemistry teacher, mathematics teacher, English teacher, Sanskrit teacher, etc., etc. All these are laukika guru. Laukik means worldly. Worldly teacher, he who teaches you things about the world. Then comes, so we all went through that. Then comes, the second is a teacher or acharya, whom one comes across as one enters the spiritual path. Acharyas are available all the time, but you are not available. At the right time, you become available to the acharya. What does acharya do? He tells you how to live a disciplined life. He shows you, teaches you the scriptures, the nuances that are there, the contemplations that are there, the lifestyle that needs to be practiced in your own daily living, so that you become available to the knowledge of the scriptures. Because for an impure mind, if he keeps reading the scriptures not combined with the purification of the mind, then growth happens. And when mind is completely purified by contemplating on what is given in the scriptures, then there is no, because I did this, therefore I live. No, it's spontaneous. The realization happens. See. So, the second is a teacher or acharya whom one comes across as one enters the spiritual path. So, who is acharya? Who is able to give you the grammar, who is able to give you the logic, who is able to tell you what are the different paths, and is able to tell you how to do the prayers and how to do pranayama and how to do yoga and meditation, and he is living a life of discipline as given. Acharya may or may not, no, acharya, laukik guru may not know how to become successful. The worldly teacher may not know what is how to be successful, but he can teach you the methods of being successful. He may not, it is not necessary for him to practice. But acharya is one who practices what he is teaching. This is the difference. See? So the student also gets inspired that, hey, you know, he is practicing what he is talking. He is not just talk. He is walking his talk. That is acharya. Then the third is the sadguru. So first was the worldly teacher, guru. Second was the acharya, the spiritual guru. And the third is the sadguru. Sadguru is who is neither of the above. Who is sadguru? Sadguru does not teach you about the worldly affairs. And the Sadguru doesn't teach you about the scripture, the spiritual affairs. Then what does he teach? Who is neither of the above two. Sadguru is the one who helps the student not only in the study of scriptures, but also in the practice of the knowledge thus acquired in his life. And he provides this guidance not only from the books, but from the platform of self-knowledge on which he is established. So the difference between the acharya and the sadguru is, acharya can be merely knowledgeable and he is teaching without experience. I should take one step back. When I said before, acharya is practicing everything in his life, there are people, there are teachers who are practicing it in their life. They are living a very disciplined life. They teach you all the scriptures, Vedanta, everything. But they have not known. Sadguru is he who is teaching, and he has known, he has come to be established. And therefore, such a person, a Sadguru, is the one who is able to deftly guide the mind of the student in the right manner. It's not only based on the scriptures, but it's also based on his life. Because he has practiced and he has gone through the difficulties, not imaginary ones, real ones. He has negotiated through life and come to be established in the truth. And he has all that data available. And he is able to put that in context with what the scriptures are saying, and then able to guide the student. So here he is saying, but also in the practice of the knowledge thus acquired in his life. And he provides this guidance not only from the books, that is the scriptures, but from the platform of self-knowledge. So he is not talking to you. Sadguru never talks to you from the idea of improving your improving your life in the world. I'm using that word, okay? But his attention is always on how, if the student is available, how this available student can once and for all be established in the self. And for that, whatever he needs to instruct or do, he will do. And he is able to, he is doing it, he is giving difficulties to the student also, or making it difficult, or putting him in circumstances only because he is available. If he is not available, he will not do it. Only if he is available. Therefore, he is able to help the student come out of the difficulties in his life, which an acharya not established in the self is unable to achieve, having knowledge gained only from the books. So who is acharya? He is a professor. He is an acharya. Knowledge of everything, but experience of nothing. And who is a Sadguru? Who is not only well versed in the scriptures, but is established in what the scriptures are teaching. See? So if the scriptures are teaching pranayama and you have never done pranayama, and you are trying to tell the others what pranayama is, it's not going to gel because you have never practiced it. If you are not able to do the yoga positions, but you want to write a thesis on yoga positions without having practiced even one of them, what is going to be the result? It is like that.
Can we say Sadguru is a Jivanmukta
Purusha? It is. Sat means Sat means truth or eternal existence, that which exists, and that is not other than Guru, Sadguru. So Guru is that principle which is always existing. So that is Jivan Mukta only. The second aspect of the Sadguru is that in his presence one gets inspired. So you never feel low about yourself in that presence of the master. You always go away with something that will add value to your sadhana or your life. Every interaction gives you something new as a takeaway. A new vision, a new way of looking at things in this world, or new way of looking at yourself, or something has dropped in that one interaction in his presence, and that keeps inspiring you to again and again be in the presence or study under that teacher. So Sadhguru is that in his presence one gets inspired, and all the fears in our mind with reference to the world and worldly problems and self-enfoldment disappear from the mind. So what you get inspired. Inspired to do what? To make money? No. That can also happen. But you get inspired not to live a problem-focused life, but you live a solution-focused life, knowing fully well that the ultimate solution is the self. Now, if this, by God's grace, it clicks, then your love for self will be so potent that you will be, every moment you will be thinking about the self in spite of everything going on around. All the fears in our mind with reference to the world. So what is the fear of in the mind with reference to the world? Security. Will I get what I desire from the world? Will it be mine? Is someone manipulating behind my back to take away everything that I have? Possessions, relations? Will it take away my health? Will it take away my eyesight or hearing? Continuous fear is there because we are surrounded with such people and such incidences, isn't it? And we take it on ourselves that I hope it doesn't happen to me. That I hope it doesn't happen to me, that conclusion is because of fear. No hope. We are not living in hope. We are living in this abidance that, and coming to this conclusion that self is always. Self has never come and never gone. And I am that. So where's the question of hope? Where is the question of losing the self? Where is the question of gaining the self? Then where is the question of losing the world or gaining the world? Everything is the self. Understand this. You may not have got that vision yet, but work towards it. Address it. If there is some fear, address it. Why am I afraid in this situation? There's nothing to be afraid of. See, yesterday someone went to the airport. Someone called, Swamiji, my passport is. See all the questions that we get. Swamiji, my passport is expiring and my flight is today. I think their phone came just now. My flight is today. But my passport is expiring 17th of April. Will I be able to fly? How do I know? You call? She's an old lady going with her daughter. Then I spoke to the daughter. I said, what happened, Amma? She said, this has happened. I said, call DFAT. Call Singapore Airlines. Find out. They called DFAT. DFAT said, no problem. Singapore Airlines said, no problem. But the doubt is still there. Then I know someone who went here, but their flight was, three of them went, one child was sent back because passport was not valid. Some airlines have some rules. So I said, we don't know what the rule is of Singapore. So solution oriented, I said, go there to the airport yesterday. Today is their flight, 12 o'clock. I said, yesterday, go to the same flight, ask the duty manager, this is the situation, this is what we have talked to DFAT and the Singapore Airlines in Singapore. What is your take on it? And the mother and daughter went there. The duty manager said, ma'am, don't worry. I will personally check you in tomorrow. Here is my card. All the tension of last 13 hours, 14 hours suddenly melted away, and it resulted in such a relief, so much crying. See, anxiety, expectation. Here we are not even having a teacher is scriptures and teacher is teaching, don't expect to be realized. If there is expectation and if it does not on that journey, your mind is playing with you. It has not happened, it has not happened, it has not happened, then fear will come. Will it happen or not? What are scriptures telling you and Sadhguru is telling you? That you are realized every moment, there is nothing to fear. Then what do you do with the fear? Offer it at the altar of the Guru principle within you, the self within you. It will get resolved. And you see that Sadguru, look at any our Jnaneshwar Maharaj or Nivritti Nath or Shirdi Sai Baba or Satya Sai Baba or Ammachi, you read their biographies, you will see what fear is and how they manage, how they overcame it. And get inspired and do it yourself. But we like to hear the story but not practice it in our life. That is our problem. So when you come to satsangs, you learn to overcome that inertia, the tamas, which is keeping you in the loop of worldliness, and raise yourself to the higher. Where are we? And so idea of the worldly problems and the idea of self-unfoldment also disappears from the mind. Why? Self is ever unfolded. You don't need self-unfoldment. You need unfoldment of the mind. And unfoldment of the mind is reduction of thoughts in the mind. Self doesn't need unfoldment. Now, topic is self-unfoldment. So, self is perfect. The mind gets totally absorbed in the Sadguru and there are no doubts left. So, what is the Guru Dakshina that the Sadguru demands of a student? Not money, not food, not clothes, not houses, not donation. Then what? No practice also. The only Guru Dakshina that the Sadguru requires from a student is that he realizes the Sadguru, that he accepts that he is of the nature of the self, and he sees that the self in the Sadguru and the self in him are not separate.
As what he is seeing.
Get the same vision that he is established in. That is the best prasad or the best dakshina, Guru Dakshina, that a Sadguru can ask for. He will never ask. Well, who are we to say he will ask or he will not ask? He can do whatever he wants. But this is the best Guru Dakshina you can give. And when he sees this potential in any student, he pours out himself completely. In Bhagavad Gita also we are seeing the same thing. When Arjuna asks, tell me, the Krishna Bhagavan is outpouring himself because a student is available. At last, his whole life, one student he got. Afterwards, Uddhava will come. See? So, and how do you know that a student is available? That Guru Maharaj knows. He looks at the eyes, he looks at the disposition, he looks at the interest, you know, it's intuitive. The third, what's the time? Because my phone call came.
10 minutes to
9:50.
Oh, so already quite a bit time.
Yeah.
So we'll leave it here. So we have to begin from the third aspect of the Sadguru. So all this is to realign ourselves so that by the next page we come to establish in the self. If not, the rest of the book is still there. And rest of our life is still there. Whatever is left. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. For a minute or so.